Good evening. If everyone could please stand and join us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, we'll begin with accolades.
Good evening. We're very lucky to be celebrating some accolades for four students for winning the Northeast Regional Go For Launch competition by Higher Orbis and NASA. First of all, I'd like to call Christiana Cabral. Shivani Mehta. Michaela Hutton.
Unfortunately, she lost her earring, so she went back to the car to look for it. And she left her phone here, too.
So did her sister accept for her?
Of course.
Does she need a flashlight? I have one.
Okay.
While we're waiting, somebody tell us a little bit about what Go For Launch is.
I actually think the best people to tell us about Go For Launch
are our winners of Go For Launch. Absolutely. Yep. Please.
Here she is.
Oh, all right. We'll do that after.
Aditi Mehta. One more round.
And the reason we chose those flies was because it was like the ideal like lifespan of them, because the experiment has to run about 30 days.
Another reason is because their DNA is very similar to that of humans,
And so with the findings of the experiment on space, we could use that to help solve problems here, like tumors or cancer, and use how they aim to try to treat them here.
Thank you.
So is the next step a national,
yeah,
a national competition, or you won the Northeast region?
Yeah, we won for the Northeast, and we had to write a synopsis of our presentation that we did at the event for judges from around the country to judge, and they're going to send us questions, and then they'll judge from there to see who wins.
So there's four.
We're one of five.
One of five in the country.
Yeah.
Wow. Fantastic.
It doesn't get any better than that, do you think?
Yes. So I was very excited as well and proud of them because they were competing against some pretty powerful schools with reputations where they had won nationals at Science Olympiad 3 years in a row, multiple private schools. And so they sort of felt like the underdog, and they were very powerful and ended up taking that round. So it's very exciting.
Awesome. Great job.
Yeah, thank you. Congratulations to all of you. I think we're going to move public comment. We did notice that while our agenda says 7 o'clock, that on our website it is posted at 7:30. So in case people want to make public comment, we're going to move that to later in the evening. So we will move to a motion to seal executive session minutes from November 12th.
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Thank you. And we will now move to our consent agenda, which includes approval of our October 28th, 2019 meeting minutes and the appointment of our superintendent and approval of his contract.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? I just want to take a moment to say welcome on behalf of the entire school committee to Dr. Bryce and his brand new position as permanent superintendent of the Bristol Warren Regional School District. Dr. Bryce is someone who stood out to us in our interview process and came in and really hit the ground running. I think many of you have witnessed that over the last few months. He was immediately invested in the district. He immediately started reaching out and communicating with stakeholders, with families, with community members, teachers, administrators, everyone. He struck us as a very student-centric leader for our district, and we are very excited, I would say, to support him in implementing our shared vision for the district moving forward.
So I just would like to thank certainly our chair, as well as all the members of the school committee for the confidence and the faith that they have in me. I recognize that this is not just merely an appointment of one person, but this is really about the direction that the school committee wants for the entire district, a direction that is focused on our students, focused on making sure that our staff are empowered, making sure that we bring in community. I hope that over the time that you've seen that and that the work that we've begun, we will continue until we have more of our students able to participate in national, state, and international competitions and bring home great rewards because of the great work that they're doing in classrooms. So again, thank you very much. I'm really happy to be here for the next 3 years.
Okay, well, we will move on now to our agenda focus, which is RICAS and SAT scores.
Yeah, so as Dr. Santa and her team get set, I think she's going to have Mary Almeida, as well as our math coach, our only, hold on, I'm putting in a plug for math coaches, our only, our number one math coach, Christine Hughes. Here's what I would say about our state assessments. Our state assessments are a moment in time. I think what you're going to see is you're going to see some things that really signal that we're headed in the right direction. But I would also suggest that there are a few areas within the presentation that point to the work that our chair already mentioned about strengthening teaching and learning in classrooms, making sure that all of our young people are prepared. All of the shared vision that the school committee, myself, all of our staff have. And so, again, we are going to celebrate and recognize the real triumphs that we have, but we recognize that we also have some work to do. So with that.
That time of year again to share our broadcast results, our state assessment results for both broadcast and the SAT. So I'm going to start with just an overview, and I know that speaker is right in front of the screen. I don't know if there's a way to move that, Ryan. Is there a way to move the speaker? Oh, and look out for Kathy.
Let's move it the other way.
There we go, that's better. So we're going to begin with a look at the broadcast assessments for grades 3 through 8. That's the comprehensive assessment system for Rhode Island. And we'll be looking at English language arts and mathematics. And we'll discuss next steps for our broadcast results. And then next we'll move into the SAT for English language arts and math as well. I want to thank Mary Almeida and Christine Hughes for both here. They were instrumental in putting this data together. So we'll begin just a refresher on the achievement level descriptors that are used within the broadcast assessment. They're also used for the SAT as well. So we have four levels. Three is meeting expectations, and four is exceeding expectations. Two, you can see, is partially meeting, and one is not meeting. And they have cup level scores that I have up there. They are a little bit different for the SAT. The achievement level descriptors are important because they let teachers and parents know if the child is meeting the learning expectations for his or her grade level. And we'll begin with a look at English language arts. For the RICAS assessment, it's in between May 21st to May 24th for both math and ELA. Schools can elect which days that they choose to give the assessment on. For the English Language Arts Assessment, there are two sessions. Each session is approximately 2 hours, and within that time, students read a variety of texts, and then they answer multiple choice questions and also written responses. So we're going to start with a few highlights, and number one, we want to congratulate Rockwell School, who has the highest ELA scores in the state for grades 3 through 8. So that is a huge celebration. We're very excited about. They've worked very hard over the past few years. Their staff is really focused on advancing learning at every level. Grade level teams work exceptionally well together, and with the implementation of core curriculum, using assessment data to pinpoint learning needs, and providing intervention as soon as students begin to fall behind. And their efforts have paid off. So last year they scored very well also, but this year to be number one, I think, is pretty impressive for them. We have a few other highlights. In addition to looking at how well students are achieving, We also want to look at students who are exceeding the expectations. So this slide shows the percentage of students within each school who has exceeded the standard. So again, earlier we have meeting the standard, and now we're looking at exceeding. For Colt Andrews, they had 5 students that exceeded on both math and ELA. For Rockwell, they had 7 students who exceeded the standard on both math and ELA. And at KMS, we had 20 students in that category.
Yeah, I think one of the things when I look at this slide, Erin, as we looked at it, talked about it earlier, I think it's important for the entire school community to understand that we have really talented students in every single school. While we certainly celebrate Rockwell and the work that they've done, but we recognize that all over this district, there are really bright kiddos, and our job is to make sure that we are supporting teachers with the curriculum, with the professional development and pedagogy so that they can help these young people to rise to this level of achievement.
I'm sort of going to break my rule because I didn't ask you this question before, but somewhere along here, are you going to show us 5% of students that you called exceeded expectations in this latest test? What happened last year? How many? So I'm talking about the growth.
Right.
So for example, did Rockwell actually grow, or did they stay static?
We have some more information on that, but that's
right,
a great
thanks.
Question. We also wanted to highlight that we had a number of students who were just right at the cusp, just a few points away from exceeding. Across grades 3 through 8, we had 78 students who were just very, very close, just a few points away, so those numbers would have been higher. And it's always a little frustrating when you look at data and you see that group of students who was just there, ready to go. And we also had 8 students who had perfect scores, the highest score possible on the assessment.
So, all right, 2 things. So the kids that I'm often interested in finding out are kids that are right on the cusp. And sometimes, in some language, you'll hear people call them bubble kids, because they're right on the bubble, the cusp of moving to the next highest section. And so the fact that we've got 78 students really should highlight the work that should be done this year. Back to the school committee member's question about, are we moving students, right? What happened to the students? These are students that are points away with a year of good, solid instruction. You would hope and believe that they would reach the next level. And then, what do you say about kids with perfect scores, other than, I think that might be the next group that we're gonna bring recommend to the school committee for recognition.
Just a scoring question. Does the determination of where, at least on the RICAS score, what constitutes a 1, 2, 3, or 4, is that, they want to say normalized based on everybody's performance? So if everybody improves, the expectation grades change, or is it a set score so that you can really truly measure whether there is, so that when you get those couple of extra points that those 78 students need, they would actually be exceeding expectations as opposed to continuing to meet expectations?
So they just went back. You see those scale scores?
Yeah.
So that's the they call it for scale score for a reason, because that's where they're trying to place kids. The one thing that I would add is that I know that in some states they potentially can set a different scale score every year. But I think in here in Rhode Island, they've been fairly consistent.
The scores do stay consistent, the cut scores, and they are consistent with Massachusetts as well. Yep, same exact test. Thank you. So let's see, where did we leave off? Oh, there we go. sorry. So you're going to also hear us talk more about growth. And in the RICAS assessment, they use the term student growth percentile. And what we're looking at is how much students grow from one year to the next. And it's defined as low growth, typical growth, or high growth. So when we're looking to close achievement gaps, we're looking for high growth. You can think of typical growth as about 1 year's worth of learning that should take place at a grade level, but to close achievement gaps, we need to have high growth. And here are some highlights related to growth. So what you're seeing up there is a percentage of students across each school that has made high growth. And then underneath that, we have some descriptors for our subgroup calculations. One of the things that we're always looking at is the achievement of all students, but particularly those students who have learning disabilities or come from disadvantaged backgrounds. We want to make sure that they're growing as well and getting any extra support that they might need. So we had high growth for a number of our subgroup populations. And later when our accountability data comes out, you'll see that we still have some work to do in those subgroup areas, but it is something else that we look at. We look at the growth of all students, and then we look at the growth of students who need more.
And Dr. Sanna, in terms of the growth, low growth or typical growth is growth that we would expect a year's worth of learning for a year's worth of seat time. Right, so we want kids at typical or high growth. And ultimately, in order to close gaps, you have to move kids further, faster. That's why high growth is so important.
Are those scores, do they account for the number of students per school? Because if you have, say, 100 students in a school and four achieve, then your percentage might appear higher than somebody who had 200 students in the school.
What they do is they come up with an average growth percentile for the school, but in addition they have cut scores for growth. So a student makes 70% or higher growth, that's considered high growth, and then they have a range for typical as well. So they have that. And
can you repeat that really quick?
I've just been wondering about that.
So just a little more information, kind of bigger picture. When determining student growth, they use peers across Rhode Island in the same grade level who had similar scores on the previous test. So earlier we talked about the scale scores. So if your scale score was 450, they would look at how other students across the state at that same level performed in the following year to determine which students had high growth and which had typical and which had low. But they do have cut scores for that. So typical growth would be between 35 and 69 for that student growth percentile. 70 and above would be considered high growth, and low growth would be below 34.
What do those numbers mean?
It means it's the points from scale score that students have grown.
Meaning if 1 year, if in grade 7, a student scored a 500, and then the following year scored a 570, that would be high growth?
That would be high growth.
But if that student only went up to 535, that would be typical growth.
Okay. Here is the comparison factor. They are compared to other students.
Want to come up with?
There is a comparison factor that plays in. So that student is also compared to other students across the state, other students in their school, in order to get that growth, scale growth proficiency. So it's not, so it's nice to look at the cohorts and see how the cohorts in our school has also grown, if they are mostly high growth, typical growth, or low growth. But it's more, it's actually three numbers, if I'm not mistaken, Diane, that they look at. So they have to look at the 2 years of testing and then the peers to see how they performed. And they average that all out to get the student growth percentile.
Thank you, Renee.
And that can could be very different than your proficiency. Because you could have low proficiency with very high grade. And that's what we aim for.
Any other questions? So here's a look at our district results by grade level, showing the percentage of students who are at each level of proficiency. And then the column to the far right shows the overall number that is looked at, and that's the total number of students meeting and exceeding. So what's interesting to note is in grades 3 through 5, we only have 5 to 6% of students who are not meeting expectations. That's a nice low number. Unfortunately, as we go up in the grade levels, you can see that start to increase. And I know, Mr. Bradshaw, last year you were very interested in why there is that dip from elementary to middle school. We've talked about that. And it's something that we continue to work on, getting our ELA teachers together and our math teachers together, but we are seeing that here.
So the other thing I would point the school committee's attention to is, as you look in that far right column, the total median and exceeding, you go from 61 down to 59, 52, 52, 44, and 49. That dip, I actually, there's a term of art, it's called holding serve. We want kids to hold serve, which means we do not want them, once they are meeting expectations at one grade level, we don't want the next year to then to slide back to partially meeting. We want our students at a minimum to hold their level of expectation, even though we recognize the rigor of the work has increased the next year, but these students are starting from a good place. So we really want to hold on to them, if not, move them to exceeding, and instead, stop the regression where students seem to have been performing, meeting or exceeding in elementary, and then they get to middle school and they're not. So it just really, I think, is a signal for all of us that we need to repurpose our efforts to focus on what's happening in middle grades, that we're not holding that same level of performance of our students.
Mr. Corral, question.
Yeah, I look at it a little differently. From the fifth grade to the sixth grade, do we have any numbers as to how many students leave us and go to private school at that level?
I don't have that off the top of my head.
See here? Yes, please.
Can you put
that up?
Question?
What was it? The amount of students that leave us from the fifth grade to sixth grade.
They are in private school, correct?
I'll go to private school.
Mr. Brown, students who are in private school this year, yes, we have.
He's looking for how many move to private school from here, from elementary school to KMS, to middle school.
Well, I can give the total of how many we have in schools in 6th, 7th, 8th grade.
What I'd really like to know is our Rockville school is doing very, very well, as we all know.
Yes.
I'd like to know how many of the Rockville students at the 6th grade level do not go to Kickamuri and go to a private school. Because if they are achieving as well as we think they are, then they're also taking some scores with them. And we know that those scores are taken away from us, then our expectations drop.
So, you know what, I think that's data that we will get back to, that we'll go and we'll pull. Like, we don't want to try to do it now, but we will get that data for you, and then I'll send it out in an update at the end of this week. I do want to, however, make the argument that while students at Rockwell are performing at high levels, as evidenced by their number one state ranking, we actually believe that we have students in all of our schools that are performing at high levels. And so I think it's an interesting point that we need to look at, but I don't wanna make the hypothesis that we think kids are leaving one school out of the district, and that's why the scores may be stagnant or dip. I really think that we need to unpack it and figure out, do we have a teaching and learning issue, like a real teaching and learning issue in the middle school where maybe because students are getting older, the requirements are changing, are we as detailed in terms of support and structure? Are we, in some cases, burning kids out? And so let me just tell you what students at the student advisory, the first student advisory that I had on Thursday, students reported from the middle school that there are days in their schedule where they are spending an hour and a half, 2 hours, sitting in one class, same subject, where they never move. And the idea of whether or not they can be engaged at a high level for that long a period of time with no movement, I think is something that we need to at least explore.
Well, having gone to this town for years, I know many of the people that I know, some of my students that I've had in class, want to move into the Rockville district and have moved into the Rockville district. And they are those parents who are encouraging their kids and they're right there with their homework, et cetera, et cetera. And I would say that the majority, I would almost like to say all, but the majority of those Rockville students have got an enormous amount of support at home, which many students in the Gutierrez, they get the Hugh Cole, COVID would not have. And then those same people, I always have a problem with all the students that I've had who would become doctors, lawyers, and Indian chiefs, right? But they don't send their kids to our public schools because they don't think it's good enough for them, I guess. And they should, because they were successful coming out of this school. Yeah. And we have a very, very good school, whether it be Rockwell or Colden. By the way, just to let you know, I have three granddaughters at Colden, so I mean, I do believe in that school too. But I believe that is one of the reasons why those scores drop. And I think if you look at it closely, you'll see that many of those people, parents in that area, will send their kids to Rockwell because Rockwell's got a great reputation. And they won't send them to Kikamura because it doesn't have a good reputation as Rockwell does. But that's just my philosophy.
We will certainly look into that and provide a response to the entire school committee.
Actually, before we move on a slightly maybe related but separate point, that is that change in performance from the end of elementary school to the beginning of middle school something that is consistent or a general trend statewide? Where middle school performance drops off generally?
Yes. Not only statewide, but I would actually suggest that it's a national trend, that we tend to see a shift and a decrease in student performance as they exit elementary and move into middle grades. And it is something that requires significant examination so that we can figure out how we get them the whole serve.
Yeah, and I would just suggest that it's worth examining that from two different directions. One is what you've already said, which is what we are doing and looking at what we're doing in our schools. But the other, if it is consistent not only statewide but nationwide, it's worth an analysis or at least having a really firm understanding of where the standard comes from, starting in sixth grade, how it's set, where it's set, and how it's being measured, so that we, we've got a clear understanding of whether the expectations that are being established are fair, as well as whether we're doing what needs to be done in order to meet those standards. Because, you know, it doesn't make sense, really, that as a general rule, kids would be doing better in fifth grade at the end of fifth grade than they're doing at the end of sixth grade. Not to suggest that the sixth grade standard is too hard or that the fifth grade standard is too easy, but maybe just that there's too much of a gap built into the system to fairly be measuring this stuff and then saying our schools are doing well or not doing well. And that, I think it's worth examining.
So we have an outlier here. So we talked about whether or not other districts experienced that same middle school dip what you're looking at here is a comparison of other districts. So we have data for Portsmouth, Barrington, Middletown, and North Kingstown. And both North Kingstown and Middletown have similar demographics to Bristol Warren. Look at what happens with Barrington. They are the blue bar. They are lower in the elementary level and then shoot up in the middle school level. And I find that so interesting. So, but it's a great topic, especially when we look also at mathematics, because we know that there are some foundational skills that really have to be mastered by the end of grade 5 before moving on.
Yeah, I mean, when I look at that graph, so I get the Barrington, right? They start lower, they have a dip, and then they shoot up until you wonder. But the question I have is North Kingston, right, which looks like they are basically holding serve, except when they get to 7th and 8th. There's a dip 7th and 8th, and just wonder what they're doing in terms of curriculum, practices, structures, like schedule matters, right? When are we teaching English language arts? Who's teaching English language arts? When are we teaching mathematics? Who's teaching? All of those things, how much time built into the schedule, all of those things I believe have to be worthy of review and examination.
I would just point out on that anyway, because that's the percentage that we meet or exceed, right? And for Bristol Warren, we hold serve on that measure from 5th to 6th grade. Mm-hmm. When we're not holding serve, is the percentage that are not meeting, right? So, you know, it seems like that's a slightly different measure.
Yeah, let's look at it.
If I go back here, you can see at the end of grade 5, 52%, and end of grade 6, 52%.
And then we fall off.
Right, so, you know, it's not like, I mean, we're kind of look a lot lighter, maybe even a little bit better there. North Kingstown in terms of the whole surf metric, because where we go down and we go back up at 7th and 8th grade, it's the drop off. But you know, the not meeting piece of it is where we're going.
And there are so many different factors that can impact assessment results for 1 year. Just having a teacher out for long term absence and having a substitute in, there are all of these different factors that play into this. But we do often look at other districts and what their schedules are, what types of math programs that they're using, and what their practices are. So anyway, I'll move on. I have just a couple of more slides for ELA. The next one might look a little confusing. It's a longitudinal look. So if we look down the bottom left hand of the screen, you'll see it says grade 3. And that's 2015, and then if you move up, you can look at that same cohort of students over a 5-year period to see if they were maintaining their gains. And again, it's not 100% to look at because you have different students that come in and out, but it's just another picture of another way to look at our data. The line that you see separating the last two columns, that's when we switched from the PARC assessment to the RICAS assessment. And you'll notice some NTs in there for not tested at those grade levels. So again, just another picture to help us think about our data and performance over time.
I have a question. In grade 10, 2015-2016, you're telling me that it was 24%. Was that a unique class you had in 2016?
That's a different group.
No.
But it was also, I believe, a concerted effort on the part of the English department, if I remember correctly, at the high school, to focus on language. And it took us up to like 30. Really, really hard.
I don't know who's the problem. Let's just get the problem. They tripled this course.
Right. Yeah, but that was a concerted effort by Major Jackson across the board in that particular year to make that happen.
And that, I believe, was the first year of Park, and that's when we had all the Park opt-outs. And the following year, parents stepped on board and they said, we're not going to let that happen again. We want our students to participate. So a couple of different factors, but yes, Mr. Jackson was instrumental in making sure that teachers understood the assessment and that they were preparing students with the types of texts and questions that they would give.
And just to clarify, we follow the chart by the colors, right? So,
yes.
So in 2015, the seventh graders that were in 2015, that's how they performed in 2016 as eighth graders. And then that's how they performed as in 2017 as ninth graders.
Correct.
Right. And typically, we do see an increase when they go from middle to high school. So again, just another picture, another way to look at the data. And we'll sum up the ELA section by just discussing some next steps. So when we look at our results, if our core instruction isn't preparing 80% of students to be proficient with the standards, then we have some work to do. We want to go back and revisit our instruction. We currently have a group of teachers and administrators that are part of a statewide initiative to research effective programs that are out there. As you know, when the Common Core standards came in, publishers weren't prepared, and we were told to hold off and not make any purchases. This group, there's a national group called Ed Reports that has been vetting materials. It's a very expensive process. They have reports for us that we can go in and see what programs actually are aligned. So we have a team of teachers working on that K through 8. And again, we'll continue to work on our intervention and our response to students who have needs. Rather than wait and let gaps grow, we want to have the resources to intervene early so that we don't create those gaps year to year. Anything you'd like to add, Gary, on that?
No, the Ed Report, I think, is really important because the whole state has moved to looking at really highly qualified and standard-based materials that have been proven to be successful. So we are, I believe, the third cohort at Rye doing this, and it's going to be K through 8 curriculum we're looking at. There is a school-level task force at, from all schools, representatives, and then there's seven people who actually attend the Rye training and are part of that cohort. So we bring back that information and work with teachers at all schools and KMS to really evaluate these programs. So we really are working to go in that right direction. We need something to kind of spark and move, especially our middle school. What was interesting when we looked at those districts that we compared ourselves to is that some of them have the very much the same demographic background as we do. Not all, but some of them. And it didn't always correlate that the demographics and the low performance or typical performance, they were achieving higher than we are. So we like to look at some of those districts, especially in ELA, and see how we can continue to grow. And I don't have a doubt that that is the direction we would go in. Now that it's the same test, we are familiar with the released items, teachers have that opportunity. And it is an assessment that is performance-based. There should be no surprises for any students, third grade to eighth grade, taking that test. It should be the kind of reading, the kind of writing, comprehension activities that they would be doing anyway in class. So that part gives us leverage in knowing what our students need, really looking at how they respond.
Right, and I guess what I would add, when we are in classrooms, I don't know if we're always seeing the level of academic stamina that is required to read text, to comprehend, and then to write the appropriate response. And I think that's something that we have to build up. And so I think these next steps really are going to be critical for us very quickly to make sure that we've got some things in place for the second half of the school year. We can't afford to wait an entire year to have to make some key changes. We actually need to figure out where maybe one or two critical elements are right now, that if we address, we address them, and then we make sure that we put that into practice for the PD days, which are coming up on January 2nd and 3rd, for the remainder of the school year. And we'll do that while, in addition, also looking to try to figure out, is it a question about the standards, right? And, you know, is our curriculum aligned to the standards, making sure that we are teaching things that students will be assessed on?
So, the question that I have revolves around the teaching of the material. So, when they're taking this assessment, they're taking, you said, in April, March, April, May, I think they have a few weeks.
So April to May.
April to May. That's only about two-thirds of the school year. Are they being expected, are the questions and are the assessments that are occurring expecting them to have the full year's worth of knowledge, or are they only expected to know two-thirds of the year? Because if I'm taking this test in April, or if I'm one of the early adopters and I take this test earlier, I've got my compatriots at other schools may have 4 more weeks of teaching and learning that occur that can prepare them a little bit better. So is the assessment really timely, is the question. Are they asking us, you should know this by the end of fifth grade, but we're only going to ask you two-thirds of the way into the school year?
So it's a great question, and I know that states struggle with that, because if we wait till the end of the school year, then we don't get the assessment results back until farther into the school year. So we've tried that as a state. We also tried giving the assessment in March, and that didn't work either. So with the ELA standards, it's a little bit different in that throughout their career, they're reading informational text, they're reading literary text, they're writing in response to it. So it's not so much that the skills change, and although there are some shifts at each grade level, the way that the curriculum is set up, we intentionally put those things more towards the middle of the year so they've had exposure to them. So to address that issue, it's how you set up your curriculum so that you make sure that students get the majority of instruction before they do the assessment.
So for ELA, you might be building, or it's the same concepts year to year. But in math, that's completely different.
Correct.
Right? And maybe that's a reason that we're seeing lower math scores, is because our kids are being assessed on something that they haven't learned yet. And it's something that we would expect them to learn in May or June, but they're being assessed on it in
so
April.
Probably our first year of RICAST, we might have seen that, or even with PARC, I'll go back to PARC. But we learned that lesson, and with the curriculum developers that we worked with, they showed us how to do that so that you get those major concepts in two-thirds of the way through the school year, and you save something at the end that is not a high focus area on the assessment. So I'll use the example of geometry. When you look at the test design, there are not a whole lot of geometry questions, so that's a safe thing to stay keep till the end of the school year. And poetry might be another area, so it's how you set up your curriculum, and most of the publishers do that as well. So you know the major content areas within an assessment, and then you have other standards that are called supporting standards. They're still taught. They should still be assessed by the classroom teacher, but they're not that focus area. Because if you remember that the RICAST can't assess every standard every year, but they tell you in advance what those major clusters are that will be part of the assessment.
And we're confident that our teachers are teaching to those focus areas every year?
We are, through our curriculum and our programs that we have. However, that goes back to the fidelity of implementation. If we're not watching teachers and supporting them with pacing, and I shouldn't say watching, if we're not supporting teachers with pacing to make sure that they realize the importance of getting to that major content, then you might have 3 units at the end of the year that never get taught because teacher runs out of time, and that means that students don't have access to that learning. So we try to be flexible enough. We don't want everybody on the same page on the same day, but we do want people
scope and sequence so that they have time to teach the concepts and students have time to learn.
I think, so that is the absolute pinpoint answer. The only other thing that I would add is that this conversation for the school committee, for our community at home, should be a reminder that everything in education matters, right? It is all interwoven together in a way that we need operational excellence, right? We need to be able to focus on conversations about this and not other conversations that we may have had in past years. Because when the focus is on this, it gives us enough time as a staff to really start unpacking what the data tells us, and then we might find those one or two effective practices that are not being implemented across the board, and then we can do professional development on it, implement it, and we should be able to start seeing results. I think teachers teach really, like, okay, first of all, I say this all the time, the toughest job in this district is being a classroom teacher, walking into a classroom every single day with a great lesson. Our job is to support teachers, give them professional development to help them gain the knowledge and content, as well as in pedagogy, as well as conduct observations so that we are helping to make sure that they are aligning their teaching with the pacing guide and the structures that we've identified. And then I think lastly, it's helping students and parents to recognize the importance of, and I come back to it, academic stamina. You cannot become academically proficient and successful if you are not working and grappling with your, you know, informational text over a period of time. If you are not writing and editing and rewriting your drafts, right? That's why we have writer's workshop. If you are not practicing those concepts in mathematics as we get to mathematics. And so it takes everything coming together, but we certainly recognize our role in this. But I would just say the most important thing is that every day we walk in and it's an opportunity for teachers, students, in the presence of content.
Just to follow up on that. So what I was wondering when Brian was talking was, I always thought the main point of these state tests was so that districts and, you know, schools, districts, states could look at how students are doing and see where improvements in teaching and learning needed to happen. So I'm wondering if that is still the main purpose of these, and if it is, to Brian's point, I'm wondering if, for example, those results are being looked at for that purpose, then if there happens to be something on the test that would normally be taught perhaps at the end of a school year, post when the test is given, wouldn't those results show that that is what's occurring?
We have what's called an item analysis, and so they give us the results for every student for probably 15 to 18 of the test questions, and they can tell us if it was multiple choice, what the correct answer was, and what our students selected, or which students didn't even attempt the problem, so that is very telling as well. For the constructive response or written responses, it also tells us our score in those areas. And what's telling is when we look at it across, and we look at that item, when we look at the standard that item was measuring, that's where we can start to see if there are standards that we're not addressing well. And overall, we don't see that. Way back when we did PARC, there were a few things like, oh yeah, we need to do more with that. But what we'll do, and we see teachers do this all the time, they'll go into their curriculum and they'll find out which units those standards are addressed in, and we'll have a conversation about, did students have enough time with that standard? Did we teach it to the same level of rigor? Did we assess it to the same level of rigor? So the item analysis is very helpful for informing teaching and learning. And then they also have released annotated student work samples, and Massachusetts uses the same ones. And so we can see how they are scored, and we can learn from that. And we can see what a 4 in writing really looks like and what a 2 looks like. So we start to calibrate our own internal assessment based on that.
I have one other question.
Go ahead.
Just one other question. This is on topic in my mind, so I hope it's translated that way. I'm just thinking about that chart again with Bristol, Warren, Portsmouth, Barrington, Middletown, and North Kingstown. I'm wondering, just because of this nationwide issue with test scores seeming to drop in that transition from elementary to middle school, I guess I was just thinking about how part of that conversation that I've been reading about, or that I've seen, is about how middle schools are set up, and so there's a conversation about like restructuring middle schools and whatever. But so I guess I was just wondering if we know if all of the schools we're being compared to, first of all, I just think that's something to think about. But also, I wonder if all of those schools have the same 6 through 8 set up in their middle schools or not.
Portsmouth does not.
What are they, K-8?
No, Portsmouth is 4 through 8 in their middle school.
Middletown is 4 through 8.
And Middletown is 4 through 8. And those are more for structure because of their buildings. So that's why they have 4 through 8, not because of
educational needs. Yeah, I just wonder if that affects.
Yeah, I mean, I think it does, and I've seen, it's interesting, I haven't seen the 4-8 configuration, but a previous district went, you know, pretty significantly into K-8, and what you see is the level of performance seems to stabilize, like it doesn't get as high, but it also doesn't drop as much. It sort of stabilizes, because if the students are there over a period of time, they get to be known by the faculty. The downside we found was that oftentimes you don't have the same level of content knowledge on behalf of the teachers, because many of the teachers are elementary certified and you don't have the secondary certification in many cases. So, not just everything, there's a cause and effect to everything. We just need to figure out what the cause is for that decline. Is it, you know, because we've got, you know, kids leaving the district? Is it because we haven't quite figured out what the test is teaching and haven't collaborated our teaching to be very specific about that content, or is there something else? So.
Anyone else have any other questions?
Okay, before we move on from ELA, I just want to acknowledge Mary Cabral, who's in the audience, and she's on our ELA cohort team, investigating programs and doing all of that research with us. So thank you, Mary, for your part in that.
Thanks, Mary.
So next we'll move on to mathematics. For the math portion of the assessment for RICAST, there are 2 sessions, and each session is about 90 minutes long. In grades 3 through 6, calculators are not allowed. In grades 7 and 8, they're only allowed for one portion of the test. So again, we'll start with some highlights. We always like to take a look at students who are exceeding. We know we have our students who are proficient, but again, always remarkable to look at the students who are exceeding expectations on a very rigorous assessment. Again, we need to acknowledge Rockwell for being the 4th highest in the state for their mathematics scores. Here are some more achievement highlights. We talked about those students who were just on the cusp, just a few points away, and we have in grades 3 through 8, 53 students who were just a few points away from from also exceeding the standard. And again, we had 4 students who received a perfect score for mathematics.
Awesome. Question?
Yeah.
What schools do the 4 students attend?
One is the middle school.
One is the middle school. I don't have that right in front of me.
We will find out.
Mr. Bradshaw.
Do we know if any of the students that scored perfectly in math also scored perfectly in ELAs?
We would have to cross-reference that. I know I saw a number of students who exceeded in both math and ELA, but for that particular perfect score, I don't know. We'll find out.
Hey, could you also list the 53 students, along with those 4 students, what schools they attend?
Will do, yeah. So let's move on and take a look at growth. So again, we're celebrating the percentage of students in each of our schools who had high growth, and also the high growth within our student subgroups. So that tells us that the support that we are providing to these students is helping them to make this higher growth, which is a good thing. That's part of closing the achievement gap. So even though you may not see much of a difference in your proficiency levels, when you see that higher growth, you know that students are getting there. Again, the district results showing the percentage of students at each level. So we can see the students who are not meeting all the way up to the students that are exceeding. In the column to the far right is the overall total number or percentage of students meeting and exceeding the expectations. Here's the longitudinal results again, showing the results as students move up from grade to grade over the years. And here's that colorful slide again, showing how our math results compare to other districts in Rhode Island. So again, you can see we talked about the shift from 5th to 6th, and we need to find out what Barrington is doing, because it's a significant jump, but we can see our performance.
Yeah, so I don't want to necessarily, well, let me just weigh in here. I actually think between this slide and if you go back, I think 1 or 2 slides, I think this is the slide that causes me to believe. All right, so the question is our curriculum misaligned to the state assessment? We don't believe so. And the reason why we don't believe so is because we actually have a number of students in early grades that are meeting or exceeding expectations. So then the question becomes, what are the other possible reasons why we have students at younger grades that are performing? And then if you go forward one, all right, so let's pick third grade in 17, 18, and 19. So third grade in 17 was 59%. In the fourth grade, they're now down to 46%. And in the fifth grade, they're at 48%. I think we have to unpack why we're seeing such volatility in our performance, right? Because that's the only way that we're gonna be able to try to figure out how we move them forward. If you look at the green box, if you look at grade 5 and 17, they are at 48%. In sixth grade, they dropped to 32%. Then they dropped to 28%. Right? This is urgent for us. We have to figure out what it is. And if it's the curriculum, we have to, by the way, if it's the curriculum, we need a new curriculum. If it is the curriculum, that is the problem. We absolutely need a new curriculum. curriculum. I just don't know if we have enough information for us to say it's the curriculum, is it professional development, are we doing something on a day-to-day basis that is not helping us to hold serve with students early on as they get older. I don't know. Are we like Christine? Is Christine going to do?
Christine,
she's our math person.
Yes.
I let's also say that in our elementary, we have a close knit with the reading support. So one thing about Math Common Core is that it is very real life application. So that means it's words. It is not numbers on a page. So a student gets a lot of reading support in a core classroom in an elementary setting than they would in a middle school setting because of the accessibility and the fluidness of a core teacher in an elementary setting because they work with the reading specialists and they help out with the math in that sense. So mathematics is not separate from reading in any sense of the word. It is, you have to have comprehension in order to succeed to perform the rigor of the standards. Yes?
Oh, I have a separate question, I'm sorry.
Yes, that's okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And Christine has been instrumental with working with the elementary teachers and beginning with the middle school teachers as well. So at the elementary level, we have one of the math programs that's highly vetted. It's meeting all of the marks nationally for alignment to Common Core. But again, it's not just the program, it's the implementation. So over the past several years, she and Sarah Bogdan, the other math specialists that we had, would work with teams of teachers on making sure that the content was there, making sure that the instructional practices were strong, and also using the data that comes from the lessons to make sure that we know if we're reaching all students. So Christine deserves a lot of credit for her work in doing that and creating that culture of learning. At the middle school, we are in our second year of new curriculum. So last year was the first year trying it out, and this year we are going stronger with it, and we do need more professional development, and we do need the support of a math specialist there in the middle school full-time to support this learning. So what the results that we're seeing now aren't the results necessarily of that new program, because it will take at least 3 years for teachers to get that program under their belt and to be able to use it in all the ways that it's possible. So that's kind of where we are. Similar to next steps for ELA, we want to strengthen core instruction. We want to make sure that as concepts are being taught, that we're teaching them in very deep ways and that students are understanding and being able to apply those skills over and over. We need to increase professional learning and collaboration so that we can grow effective practice, celebrate the things that are working well in classrooms and grow them. And once again, strengthen the intervention piece for students who are struggling, make sure that they get the direct support that they need so that we can close those achievement gaps. And also to continue to engage our advanced learners through differentiated approaches and make sure that their needs are being met as well. Any other thoughts, questions before I move on to SAT?
I have a question about math. We have not historically done well in math in this district. And I will admit to the fact that I never quite understood the way we taught math sometimes. And I will also admit to the fact that when my children were growing up, the times tables were on the ceiling. And when they went to bed at night to practice the times table, because they didn't practice it in school. And one of the things I know about math, and there isn't a whole lot I know, but I do know that math builds on itself. And while you have to solve problems along the way, but there are a significant number of word problems that come along with math, if you don't have the skills, the basic skills that you learn in elementary school, how do you build? What are you building on? You're not building on any skill that takes you to the next level where you're working in your head. How many of us don't use a calculator? You just
average in our head for percent off or what the change is. We can do that in our heads because we've learned that foundation early, and I'm worried that while we're so focused on the literacy part of it, that we're forgetting about the basic foundation of math, addition, which I call arithmetic. It's addition and subtraction, multiplication, division, times tables, fractions, decimals, all of them. I mean, Christine is great, and I know she knows what I'm talking about, but I think we went away from that a little bit, and we need to come back.
Yeah, we recently started, I guess it was last year, that we realized that we need to go back and we should refocus on fluency, basic math. Actually, I'll let Christine talk a little bit about what she's done.
Yes, and that's what you're addressing, and to be able to know your multiplication facts fluently. And fluently is like knowing another language. And so being fluent is as if you can speak it and just know it without much thinking. So many of our students are working towards fluency, and that's, there are standards that by the end of first grade that a child should be able to do their sums to 10. And by the end of second grade, we should be able to do our adding and subtracting through 20 fluently, mentally, with mental strategies. So we're building in those strategies and those visual models to help them with those building blocks to proceed. And third grade is multiplication, just like it was. And so those things really still haven't changed. And that is a strong component in our math workshop, is a fluency station that students work with, having number flexibility as well, because not all of our learners can remember defects. So they also need a next level. Then what's going to be their strategy to get to it? Because this, with our cell phones, we're not memorizing cell phone numbers anymore. So like we need to have a strategy of how we're going to get there if we're not confident in being able to memorize it. So we're teaching them those strategies as well. So there's lots of definitely that has not been forgotten. And there's an emphasis. Our two Title I schools, we have a, we've been supported to be able to have a fluency program that's been high interest, that it's called Reflex, that our Colt Andrews and Hugh Cole are both using this year. And so that was to spark this energy of needing. So how do we spark the excitement of fluency?
I was just gonna bring that up because I have three daughters in the district, and my third is 7 and in the second grade, and the first one to use Reflex Math, as far as I know. But as you were talking, it just made me realize that this is clearly an effort to make the kids more fluent in math, because it's just like right now, second grade, it's doing those same skills, like addition and subtraction in boxes that turn a color and then into an animal, you know, which is really exciting, but it's repeating the same equations over and over and over, it seems like, I think, so that they're just second nature when you see them.
Yes.
Or when you're doing what in your head in real life. Is that?
That's exactly the goal. So that is a high interest program that you would see. And so it repeats the different problems, and they actually changes, it's adaptive to what they are fluent in. So it keeps track and gives the teacher feedback on that as well.
Just never understood. 1 + 1 = 2.
And
you can tell, and you can tell somebody that they need to know that because it's snowing outside. But they need to know 1 + 1, whether they like it or not. And those are, so you're talking about different strategies to get them to do that. But at the same time, I expect them to come out of those grades having that core knowledge.
80% of our students should. Yes.
Before they attempt the next level.
Yes. And so one thing that could be make an impact on our middle school as well is the fact that up until fifth grade, most of their basic computation is larger numbers growing of something that they're secure in. And then in sixth grade, they're doing ratios. They've never seen, that's nothing to build on naturally, that the sixth grade teacher has the gift to bring in their concepts of what they learned in fifth grade to introduce their ratios. But, so that also impacts how we perform as years go on too.
Yes.
I think someone may have touched on this before, but I just, you know, we're always talking about if a child does not master reading at a third grade level by the end of the third grade, they're destined possibly to doom to not graduate from high school. And so I'm just wondering, is the drop in the later grades an indication that reading aptitude has not been accomplished for all?
So I'll have Mary, do you want to talk a little bit about, and we don't have it right in front of us, but if we were to look at all of our data, not just RICAS, but other data for grade 3 reading, that certainly is a very key area that we look at, and I'll have Mary address that more. And just to connect with math before we shift back to ELA for a second, also we know that by the end of grade 5, that's another key critical point, and student success with all of those math concepts in fractions, ratios, decimals by grade 5 or perhaps even earlier, we were discussing this today, that's an indicator of their performance on Algebra 1. So those are things that we're looking at, the research and what that tells us, and thinking out how do we build those benchmarks in. However, we don't want to go to the extreme that states such as Florida have done, where if a student does not pass the grade 3 state assessment, they have to be retained, and they will stay retained until they pass that. So it's a fine line, but I'll let Mary tell you some of the work that we're doing around grade 3 literacy.
So to that question, if we look at our RICAS scores, and then we also look at our local assessments, not in every school because the performance is different in different schools. We do have some schools where 30 to 40% of our students are not reading on grade level. So that is, ouch, that is not where we want to be. So in the last 3 years, the state has really had an impetus to get all kids reading, at grade level by the end of third grade. 3 years ago we said no, we want all our students reading at grade level by the end of second grade. But we also look at our local assessments, our NCAS data, especially K-2. It is driven by reading records, by seeing how children are processing. We are in the third year of our foundations, which provides really poor instruction in phonics and phonemic awareness. But I am a firm believer that phonics and phonemic awareness are only the tools to get meaning out of print. So we have work to do in word study, vocabulary, because nothing increases comprehension and the skills that the standards really want students to be able to do as much as that broad vocabulary. So there is a deficit in some homes, in some communities, some schools, in which children do not come to school with the 5,000 words that other kids come to school. Actually, I think it's like 20,000, and the deficit schools are 5,000. So we need to really cater to focus on reading comprehension, and the other part of that, the reciprocal part, is writing. We are doing Calkins writing. It is a great writing program for writer's workshop, but there are other levels of writing that start pretty much as young as kindergarten, responding to literal text, to literature, responding to informational text, that we need to also strengthen. So it's literacy. We don't want to separate reading and writing. We don't want to say that if we have a strong core program K-3 and they can all read the words, that necessarily means they are literate. Because then we have a reverse problem where children are word callers. They can decode anything, but to get at the deeper meaning, the different levels of comprehension, or the critical levels, interpretive levels, they're not. And sometimes I think that's where we see the drop in the middle school, because the expectations now, the bar is set much higher. And we've kind of set them off up to third, fourth grade to do that third and fourth grade work, but from fifth and above, it is much higher analysis in writing, really critical thinking. So yes, I think Dr. Bryce said it earlier, we have to increase their stamina, increase their rigor. And really, for those students who may not come to school with those 20,000 words, who may have homes where they're not reading as much, we have to give them the extra, whether it's extended day in tutoring or before school tutoring. We have to make sure that we, for the 6 hours we have them, we are giving them everything they need and then some. But that's the reality. I hope I answered your question.
So Mary, yes. You have this rigor going on, and are the children adapting to it? Are they grasping it? Is there some change?
I would say that a good 60 to 70% of our students, yes. It is amazing to see the growth in kindergarten, first grade, second grade. And I say that because they're very high standards that people will say, oh, you know, they can't really do all of that in kindergarten. But when we see them at the beginning of the year, when we see them in May, it is amazing what they can write, what they can read. It's really keeping that momentum. We also don't offer any summer programs, which we did 7-8 years ago. There is a summer slide, it's real. We know that from our MCLAS testing, our STAR testing. There is a slide. And we've tried on a small scale with our Title I schools to provide some kind of summer enrichment, and of course, extended school year with children who have IEP is required. But it's not enough. So we are a district where our demographics also play into our scores. We are 33 to 35% free and reduced lunch. Some of our neighbors, Portsmouth, Barrington, I'll say it, they're in single digit, maybe in the teens somewhere. So they might be, Barrington probably is a macrocosm of Rockwell School, who has very low SES. So that is the reality, but I'm not saying we can't overcome that. We want to be like some schools in the nation who are high SES and high performing. That's where we want to take all our students. But it takes work, and it's the work of teachers, it's the work of reading specialists, math coaches, all of us really working and looking at why are there gaps here and not there. That being said, if you looked at the growth for ELA, and Diane hasn't done the SAT yet, but you'll see it there too. Our district serves economically challenged students very well. The growth for students, they use the word economically disadvantaged. I like to say challenge. Our students who are economically challenged, their growth has been the same or comparable to non-SES students. So that tells us that we are serving that population very well. And also our ELL population. So that's, does that answer the question? Thank you.
Yes, Claire. I had a couple of interesting things I wanted us to sort of think about. I've been thinking a lot lately about our teacher absenteeism concern that we have, and I wonder how those are relating to our general test scores, and maybe we have a higher absentee that's present at the middle school, and maybe that has something to do with data drops. The other thing I was wondering, if there was any way that we could look at this data, because I'm a data nerd and I like my statistics. How many of the kiddos, when we're seeing drops, have needed social emotional supports? How many of those kiddos have trauma in their homes? How many of those kiddos are just having tough time that they need to be doing a better job of serving them as far as social emotional learning and other sorts of counseling resources? So I'm wondering how those sort of ideas and concepts fit into the scores.
Yeah, so I mean, I think two things. Number one, I think the issue around absences is not just staff absences, it's also student absences, right? So it's anytime students are not available for learning, for instruction, It's those times when staff are not there. Is there a solid, credible substitute plan, or is it a worksheet, right? And so let me just say, I think that as we look at teacher staff absences this year, I think are trending in a more favorable light, and that's a good thing. But I recognize that there are times when absolutely staff need to be absent, and that's why the school committee has provided those for them. And so we're not suggesting that staff can never be absent.
Right.
But I do think the issue becomes, if staff is absent, what happens in their absence? And I'm not certain that we get the same level, high quality teaching and learning during that absence that we would if they were there. So that's number one. And then I think to your question about social emotional, I think the issue for social emotional supports is one that we actually need to create an environment where all students feel that school is an inviting place, that it's a welcoming place, that we're doing things to support them. And as I mentioned earlier from my student advisory held last week, when a student said that they sat for an extended period of time dealing with the same subject matter with no movement, and that was repeated, so that wasn't just one, it wasn't an isolated response. I think we also have to ask the question, are we structuring the time students are using for teaching and learning in a way that is most beneficial to them learning at high levels? And so we ask the question, we should get the data to figure out if so. And if not, we do something. But if it's okay, then we know that that's not a place that we need to address. I think the last thing is just, this is the type of conversation that I think myself and staff want to have with the school committee, which is about the essence of who we are as a school system. Because if we get this right, everything else gets better. But in order to get this right, we also have to have organizational or operational excellence. There are just things that happen that need to be handled very quickly as a routine matter so that we can get our focus on teaching and learning in schools.
I'm wondering, so if some of those kiddos that are having difficulty not meeting expectations are the kiddos that have maybe been in and out of the Connections classroom, are those considered chronically absent? Just trying to think about how we can raise those kiddos.
So I'll just briefly add that when the student is struggling, we have the response to intervention process or MTSS process that's for both academics and behaviors, and that's the whole point of looking at the whole child, so teachers can say, well, yes, I've been providing extra help, but the student's been absent for the past 2 weeks, so they haven't been able to receive the intervention. So I know that teacher teams do look at all of those factors, and they need to have an intervention around getting the student to school, then we will do that. So it's great. We don't just look at academics in isolation. There are a lot of other factors. So we're ready to move on to SAT, and we just have a few more slides. You want to go, John?
You prefer.
Sure.
Hey, really good. So I know in some of our talk outside the school, we're talking about the whole setting for the school. We're going to push it down to our superintendent, who has goals that he's going to push down the teachers. We are coming up with a number of variables to look at. I have my own variables too that I would like to take a look at, especially like at KMS. You know, looking at the looping teams. Is that efficient? It may be efficient on everything, but maybe math, not so efficient. You know, maybe looking at strengths of each teacher in that environment, maybe that doesn't work. I know there's also been a changeover of math teachers at KMS, and maybe that's a good thing. Maybe it's going to take them a little bit longer to get spun up. I'm not sure. But, you know, I just have one idea. Can take it for what it's worth, but maybe it wouldn't be too bad if we reached out to maybe to a university. When I was attending Brown, we got into statistics pretty big, and it seems like everybody loves statistics here. You like data and we like to crunch it all. But when we start picking these variables that we're interested in doing, maybe we can start looking at the real good variables, because you're going to get a bunch of them. But certainly you want to look at certain ones that you want to key in, and of course we can adjust it over time, but if you have the variables, then I think we can get into where we marry that up with something that Adam just brought up recently, which is the delta that we're looking for to change. What is the trend? We could look at the national level, we can look at the regional level. We can look even at Massachusetts, because I think they get the same questions as we do. I think that was stated, right? So we could look at that, but probably more in particular, we gotta focus down into, like Mary said, the economically challenged. Maybe try to level in with the other communities that kind of level. Maybe it's not so much a population issue as it is the demographic, economic side to it. And then with that, find out what that delta is. Now you've got a good starting point to say, hey, are we really succeeding or not? And then if we can punch in a few of the variables, I think we're going to get what we want in the end. I certainly think English as a second language has an impact. I like what Carl has brought up as far as the social emotional thing that we're seeing, you know, especially over the last year or two. But maybe this could be a well-packaged program. We could look to a student in the university, or if we can internally resource it, that's awesome. But it seems like every year we go through this, we keep seeing this tough transition from the elementary up to KMS, and every year I hear the same thing from Rogers, you know, and it's tough, but we bring Barrett. But I think if we know the delta, we can say, hey, we're actually doing pretty good, but we can't say that now. So I know it's going to take some time, but we got a whole year to get ready for it.
Yeah,
so,
great suggestions, and I think we definitely have more that we can learn about the data and how we can use it. And you're absolutely right. Year after year, we notice the gaps, but what's not changing is the structures that we use within schools. And many times, the teaching and learning doesn't change all that much either. So we identify these focus areas, but then we don't make the changes necessary to really address them. That's that. All righty. Going to SAT. And we just started with a summary slide here of achievement and growth highlights. So at the state level, Mount Hope High School had the second highest student growth percentile in the state, which was wonderful to see, 61%. Of that, 49% of students who were economically disadvantaged had high growth, and 43% as compared to students who were not economically disadvantaged. And we also had high growth for our English learners. PSAT and SAT results. Here you can see the comparison from last year to this year. And you see that in 2019, we were up in both the SAT and the PSAT for English language arts. And the columns to the right show you the average score for Bristol Warren and the average score for the state. So here's the slide that shows it broken down by achievement level. So you can see from last year to, from 2017 to 2018, they reduced the number of students not meeting.
That took the PSAT to the SAT. So it's not the same number of students.
that the expectations, the scale score for meeting expectations in mathematics is 50 points higher than in ELA. So for ELA, the cut score for meeting was 480, and for mathematics, it is 530. And here's a comparison, math and ELA to Portsmouth, Barrington, Middletown, and North Kingston. And the first column represents the SAT ELA results, and the second column is the math. Next steps, and it does look very similar to what we've been telling you all night, is that we know that we need to go back, and we need to make sure that our curriculum is aligned, we need to make sure that our instruction and assessment are aligned to the standards as well. For the high school, there have been a lot of articulation discussions with the middle school, especially in mathematics, and we're working on that right now with the Algebra 1 that's taught in the middle school and Algebra 1 at the high school, making sure that teachers have the resources and support to teach that effectively. And same thing with English. We've had a number of discussions with the ELA teachers at the middle school, and so making sure that our whole system is aligned to K-12. High school level, intervention approaches continue to be something that they work on. The schedule is a little bit different. And over the past few years, they've tried a couple of different scenarios, and we'll continue to take a look at that. And lastly, we want to make sure that we continue to engage our advanced learners. And just to sum up, we want to reinforce that assessment is only one factor in student success. There are many other factors that we look at and that we support within school. So it's not all about passing a test. It's also about passing, being able to use critical thinking, problem solving, communication skills, being connected to schools, having opportunities to pursue different career paths at the high school, and also that social emotional development and students having goals for themselves. So we know that assessment results are important. We know that our students need to be proficient in the core areas, but there are a lot of other things that we celebrate our students' success with. And then last slide, just that we're on our way. We're making progress. We're not there yet. We've got a lot more work to do, but we want to celebrate the work of teachers and students, and we want to continue working together as a K-12 team to plan next steps to get us closer to being top 5 in 5. So, questions? I know I went through the last part rather quickly, but
I think Mr. Batch has a question.
What grades take PSAT and SAT?
PSAT is in grade 10, and SAT is in grade 11.
So when we look at our percentage of students meeting or exceeding the standard, we're going to go across. So the PSAT in 2018, so I'm looking at the math, that scored 46% on the PSAT in 2018, took the SAT in 2019. Because it just looked odd that we had and I thought that might be the case, but then I saw the up arrow. But really for that cohort, right, we went down.
Yeah, we look at it both ways. We look at cohort, but then we also just look year to year to see, are we showing increases that way? But you're right, that would be a cohort instead of taking the SATs in school. Yes, just last year it was required as the high school state assessment.
Do we have data from prior years when it wasn't required? And is that viable data, or is that?
No, the state does not consider that viable data because of you know, wasn't, it doesn't represent all students, or it really doesn't represent how we performed as a school. Mrs. McBride?
Is it still true to make the statement that the PSATs are traditionally a little bit harder than the SATs because the there are awards that
the
National Merit Scholarship is based on the PSAT, or is that not a fair assessment?
I would think the folks at College Board, so I happen to work for a superintendent who was a member of the College Board, Board of Directors, and was really close friends with the College Board president at the time, Gaston Cameron. I think the College Board would say that the PSAT is predictive of the SAT, but that they would not go as far to say that the PSAT is harder, right? But I do believe that the College Board would say the PSAT is predictive of student success on the SAT. I don't think they would say it's hard.
I never heard that either. Mr. Bendel?
Yeah, just a comment. I think this could be utilized very instrumentally during our next joint finance meeting. I don't think we can. I mean, we can compare ourselves to Barrington, and we certainly do that here. But certainly, their Title I numbers are lower. Their medium income, I'm sure, is much higher. White collar, college bound, probably much higher percentage. But if we can find a few schools that we're more in line with at least percentages, and then tell them, hey, all right, we want to compete with Barrington even though we're here, and then give them the examples of where we're flourishing, and certainly some of the great stuff you've already mentioned, and then just tell them, I mean, it's all about resources. I mean, I think we can do that. We've done that in years past, but I think this year is bigger than probably any other year in the past. This is a big year for us.
I mean, I think